When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, no, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Oh, no. See, shame no longer has a place to hide. Oh, shame no longer has a place to hide. And I am not a captive to the lie. Well, I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. No, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Oh, no. Sing, there's power. There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Power in your name. There's power. There's power that can break off every chain. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Power in your name. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. It doesn't stand a chance. Oh, my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I.
Awesome. Good morning. How about we show our appreciation to our Encounter Band and give God the glory this morning? Great job getting us started in worship today. You guys can have a seat for just a moment. I'm Tammy Woodard, the associate pastor here at Bullard First United Methodist Church, and we are so glad you are here with us today. And if you're worshiping online, we welcome you as well. I'm going to share with you a few announcements. And while I do that, if you haven't already done so, if you'll pick up the registration books and register your attendance and pass that on down the rows, if you guys will be sure to pass it all the way over, and the offering baskets as well. Today, we have Pool Youth at 5 o'clock. That will be at the Falconberry's home. And so we're excited about that from 5 to 7. If you've got youth, if you need directions, let Katie know. She'll tell you how to get there, but I know they're going to have a lot of fun there. You guys have a beautiful place, so I know they'll enjoy that. Also, we have two things happening on August the 15th. First of all, we have our Splash Kingdom Night. That's our big, big, big outreach. And so we're asking you to do your part and invite your friends and neighbors, because we have rented out the entire water park. That's going to be on the 15th from 6:30 to 8:30. Now, you do need to register ahead of time. Everyone will need to register and sign a waiver. So be sure and let your friends and neighbors know about that. The link is in here. It's also, I think, on our Facebook page. And then the other thing that's going on the 15th will be our blessing of the backpacks. We'll have that in both services, and that's going to be on, again, August 15th. So youth, children, bring your backpacks, and we will have a special time of prayer and get them ready for the school year. Another big thing that's happening, we have a lot going on in August, is the teachers' luncheon. That's going to be on Friday this year, which is different than usual. Friday, August the 13th. Because of the huge numbers of people now that come to it, I think we're expecting about 450. We've split it into two campuses. So we're doing half, and then First Baptist is doing the other half. But we need volunteers. We need people that can help serve. It is going to be catered, but we are serving the food. So if you can help set up or serve or clean up or all of those, we would really appreciate your help. We also need people to make desserts. So if you can do any of those, please let Dori Vestal know. She's heading this up for us, and we really appreciate your help with that. Last thing is our mission barrel. Since we are going back to school, what we normally do in August is collect school supplies for our littles at the BEC campus. So that's our pre-K and kindergarten kids. We have a specific list of things that we would like to give to them. And I've made copies of that list. They're on the welcome table. So if you want to pick one of those up when you head over to Walmart or Target, pick up a few of these supplies and put them in the mission barrels. By the way, the mission barrels are overflowing with blue jeans. So thank you all so, so much. I'm going to count the number of pairs and let you know how many it is. But today is the last Sunday for that. But you all have just blessed the socks off the mission house. So thank you so much for your generosity in that. Okay, I think that's it. So how about I open us with a quick word of prayer, and you guys can usher us back into the presence of God with your music. Father God, we give you thanks, we give you glory, we give you all of our honor and our love today as we worship you. Thank you for your blessings. Thank you for your spirit that is here with us today. Now, God, let us open our hearts and pour in your love into us, Lord. And let us then pour that out into the world. In Jesus' name, amen.
At your name, the mountains shake and crumble. At your name, the oceans roar and tumble. At your name, angels will bow, the earth will rejoice, your people cry out. Lord of all the earth, we shout your name. Shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, out of your name, out of your name. The morning breaks in glory, out of your name, out of your name. Creation sings your story, out of your name, out of your name. Angels will bow, the earth will rejoice, your people cry out. Lord of all the earth, we shout your name, shout your name. Filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name. Far and wide, but I hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call. says how he loves us, oh, how he loves and oh, and how he loves us, oh, oh, how he loves us, how he loves us, oh. God, thank you so much. God, thank you for loving us even when we don't deserve it. When we could never earn it. We love you this morning because you love us. God, as we continue this morning, just stay in this place. God, open our ears, open our hearts. Show us more of who you are, Father. We want to know you more. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. I invite you to remain standing. If you've been blessed this morning by this worship, say amen. Amen. I don't know about you, but there are weeks when I come in here and kind of feels like the spiritual magnetic field around my internal compass is just off. And when I come in here and same happens for me when I'm in traditional worship as well, but when I take those times of worship, it reorients that internal compass, that internal spiritual compass, to point to its true north of Jesus Christ. And I just really appreciate David Thrasher and the band and how they help us do that. Let's once again show our appreciation to them. Give God glory. Thank you so much. This has been good for my soul this morning. Thank you so much. Well, we're going to read this morning from Philippians chapter 4, and we're going to start with verse 4 and go to verse 9. Verse 4 says, always be full of joy in the Lord. Oh, verse 6, I'm sorry, I jumped a little early. So verse 6, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for what He has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. And now, this is what I want you to hear. This is our focus verse for tonight, for this morning. And now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. Keep putting into practice all you have learned and received from me, everything you heard from me and saw me doing. Then the God of peace will be with you. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Would you pray with me? Dear Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight this day, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen? Amen. We're ending our sermon series this morning on winning the war in your mind. And it's been a good series. I hope that you've really enjoyed it, but also I hope that it's challenged you. As I believe it's challenged all of us to think about our thoughts and to think about how we think about things and our mental pathways that we create by thinking certain thoughts over and over again, and how much the thoughts that we entertain influence how we live and even the quality of our lives. And hopefully you've learned something good, some good methods to retrain your brain, to reorient your thoughts, to focus on things that are good and pleasing and positive. And with God's help, I pray that we are all living with a better frame of mind by learning to frame things differently, to see the good that is out there where God is at work, and that by doing so, our life better reflects the will of God for us. Because this isn't just been about getting good thoughts, but it's about allowing those good thoughts, those godly thoughts, to influence how we live our lives on a day-to-day basis. So, before we leave this series, we're going to touch on one final subject about winning the battle in your mind. And actually, I want to tell you, I'm actually bringing in a second resource here, a third resource, really, because our first resource is the Bible. The second resource for this series has been the book, Winning Your War in Your Mind. And the third resource we're going to talk about this morning comes from Richard Foster. It's a book called Celebration of Discipline. And he has a chapter that I reference pretty heavily here in talking about today's subject, which I'll mention in just a second, because it's an ancient Christian practice. One that, for whatever reason, has fallen out of favor in a lot of ways with folks, or it's one that's not practiced as much anymore these days, mainly because Christians today, for some reason, have assumed that this practice means something different than what it means in the Scriptures. And what I'm talking about is the practice of the Christian discipline of meditation. Now think about it. What thoughts come to your mind when I say meditation? You just think about that. You don't have to answer that. But I want to tell you that there is a Christian discipline of meditation, and that's what we're going to talk about today as a means for helping us to win the war for our minds. Now, our scripture passage speaks about meditation. I don't know if you caught that or not, but let me go back to that verse again, the one I highlighted, verse 8 of Philippians chapter 4, which says, "And now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing, fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise." Now, when the Apostle Paul penned these words, he was in chains in prison. As we learned last week, he was choosing the better frame. He was choosing to look, even in his difficult situation, about where God was at work and where he might see opportunities to join God in his work in spreading the gospel and sharing the love of God and in expanding the kingdom. And so he took advantage of those opportunities to share God's love with others. And here, Paul is continuing to encourage us to choose the better frame by meditating on good things. Now, in this translation, this is the New Living Translation of the Bible. It does not say the word meditate in that. It says the word fix and it says the word think. But in the King James Version, it ends the verse by saying this. It says, or this is actually the New King James Version. It says, "If there is any virtue and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things." Now, as I mentioned a minute ago, when we think of meditation, you probably thought about some guy or gal sitting on their on the ground on a rug with their feet, in, you know, legs Indian crossed and you know, going or doing something along those lines, you know, or you know that, you know, what we tend to think about when we hear the word meditation or meditate is Eastern religions or Eastern practices. Are New Age practices, which are clearly not Christian. They have a whole different intention and mindset when they are doing these sorts of things. And it's because of that influence, because of the popularity of those things over the years, that many Christians today won't touch the idea of meditation with a 10-foot pole. They think, oh, all meditation is Eastern mysticism, or all meditation is some New Age mumbo jumbo, or all meditation is or something along those lines. But the reality is, nothing could be further from the truth, because Christian meditation is an ancient Christian practice that has its roots in biblical Christianity and in the history of the Christian faith and in our Judeo-Christian faith. Christian author Richard Foster takes a deep dive into the subject of Christian meditation, what it is and what it isn't, in his book called The Celebration of Discipline. If you have not read the book, Celebration of Discipline, I really encourage you to pick that up. It is a great book on Christian practices, Christian habits, Christian disciplines, and he looks at them from a historical as well as biblical mindset. It is considered a Christian classic, and if you haven't read it yet, I would encourage you to go pick up a copy of that. Maybe we'll do some of that for a sermon series at another date. But in the Old Testament, he talks about how the Bible uses a couple of different Hebrew words to convey the idea of meditation. And those words are used over and over again some 58 times throughout the Old Testament. And the words have various meanings. The words mean things like listening to God, or reflecting on God's works, or rehearsing God's deeds, or ruminating on God's laws. And in each case, there is a stress upon not only the act of remembering or ruminating or pondering or thinking, but also it stresses a behavior change that comes as a result of being engaged in these sorts of activities. So in other words, Foster writes that repentance and obedience are essential features to any biblical understanding of what meditation is all about. It's as the psalmist proclaims in Psalm 119:97. He says, "Oh, how I love your law. I meditate on it all day long." And then in other parts of the Psalms, the psalmist writes this. He says in 119 verse 15, he says, "I meditate on your precepts." That's another word for laws or commandments. "I meditate on your commandments and I consider your ways." And then in Psalm 143, verse 5, it says, "I meditate on all your works. I consider what your hands have done." Now, is he saying that I'll go over there? No, he's saying, I ponder, I think, I dwell, I meditate on your goodness, Lord. I meditate on your commandments, Lord. I meditate on what you're doing in the world. I meditate on how you're working in my life. I meditate on your salvation. I meditate on what Christ is. I focus my thoughts. I fix my thoughts on these sorts of things. Now, let's make a distinction here, just to be clear. A distinction, if you will, between Eastern meditation and Christian meditation. And I think it's important to do that. In Eastern meditation, the point of meditation is to empty one's mind, to just get it all the stuff out. It's about emptying one's mind so one can become detached from the world. The emphasis is upon losing one's personhood, upon losing one's individuality, and merging with some greater cosmic flowing mind kind of a thing. It's about being freed from the burdens and pains of this life and being released into some sort of a nirvana kind of experience. It's about escaping existence. Detachment is the final goal. That's the intention, is to reach some level of detachment. Christian meditation is not that. Christian meditation, very simply, as Richard Foster says, is the ability to hear God's voice and obey God's word. It's to hear God's voice and to obey God's word by engaging God in his word. Throughout the Bible, we see stories of people taking time to meditate by giving God their full, undivided attention. For example, Isaac, it says in Genesis chapter 4, went out to meditate in the fields in the evening. Why did he go out in the fields? Because they're not workers in the fields in the evening. He could go out there and be by himself with the Lord, and he could meditate on what God has been doing in his life. He could meditate on God's word and what God was saying to him, God's commandments. And so he did that in sort of the privacy of his own fields. And the psalmist in Psalm 63 says, "On my bed, I remember you. I think of you through the watches of the night." So as the psalmist lays down at night, he meditates upon God in the quietness of his bed. Eli, the priest in the Old Testament, knew how to listen to God and help the young boy Samuel to know the voice of the Lord. Do you remember the story when Samuel comes to Eli and because God has spoken to Samuel and calls out his name, and Samuel is confused. He thinks it's Eli calling from the other room, and so he goes to Eli, says, "Yes, Eli, what do you need?" And Eli says, "I didn't call you. Go back to bed, you know." And so he goes back to bed, and he hears God call him again, and he goes. He does this a few times, and each time Eli has sent him back, except the last time Eli realizes, the Lord is speaking to Samuel. And so he says, "Go back to, and when you hear the voice again, say, 'Yes, Lord, your servant is listening.'" Your servant is meditating. Your servant is giving your undivided attention. Elijah spent many days and nights in the wilderness, it says in 1 Kings chapter 19, learning to discern the still small voice of God. What was he doing? He was meditating. He was listening to God. In the midst of his busy ministry, Jesus took time apart to spend with his heavenly Father, to listen to God. Now, we have talked about several things in this sermon series. We've talked about how we need to identify the strongholds that the enemy has that are holding us back. We need to understand the influences of our filters and how they shape the way we influence things or interpret things. We've talked about the importance about how to frame our day, to look for the good, to look where God is at work. And today, we're talking about training our minds to focus on the things of God, things that are true, that are honorable, that are right, that are pure, that are lovely, that are admirable, excellent, and praiseworthy. In particular, we're talking about how to do this by focusing our lives in on the Word of God. For God's Word is certainly that which is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable and excellent and praiseworthy. And God's Word is something that we all, let's just be honest with ourselves, all of us could do with spending a little more time in God's Word, spend a little more focus in on God's Word. It's kind of like Jackie Chan in the latest iteration of the Karate Kid movies, you know, when he played Mr. Miyagi and he looks at the person, he goes, your focus needs more focus, you know. We need a little more focus on God's Word in our lives. So how do we do this? How do we learn to meditate? How do we learn to do this? Well, first, I recommend finding your quiet place. Or like in the Old Testament, the guy went out in the fields. What's your field, you know? What's your place where you can escape? What's your place where you can get away? For some of us, that's really easy. It just might be a chair in a guest bedroom or our bedroom. Or it might be our recliner. It might be the back porch where we have coffee in the morning. For others of us, it might be a little more challenging, especially if we've got kids in the house. And we might not just need a place, but we also need a time that works for us. Maybe it means getting up a little bit earlier before the kids are running around, or maybe it means waiting until the kids are asleep, or maybe in a nap time or something like that. For others, it might be, you know, just taking time at lunch, you know, or taking a time in the afternoon. But carving out space and place and time in our lives so that we can just spend time with God as we open up His Word, His Bible, which is written to us, to allow Him to speak to us through that. Simply put, we find a place in space and time where we can be alone with God. And we can give Him, through His Word, our full and undivided attention. Now, when meditating on Scripture, Richard Foster reminds us that meditation is all about actively engaging with Scripture. This is more than just om stuff. Remember, this is we're opening up God's Word so that we can engage with God's Word. And so, first, it involves us picking a passage. Now, you could do that at random if you want, but or you can be more intentional about that sort of thing. Maybe start with the Gospels and say, you know what, I'm going to meditate my way through one of the Gospels, or I'm going to meditate my way through one of the epistles. Or maybe if you're doing the upper room, there's always a scripture passage that gives you in the upper room. Maybe for your day that day, you're going to meditate on whatever that scripture that they gave in the upper room or in your devotional materials. That's the one you're going to focus on. That's the one where you're going to listen for God to speak to you from. And so when you do that, I'll encourage you to read through it, not just once. Remember, this is not just reading for information. And reading for information is not bad, but this is reading for transformation. This is reading for engaging. This is reading for listening for God to speak to you personally about whatever it is that you are reading. So you don't just read it through quickly and say, I'm done. You take your time and just read every word. Maybe go back and read it a second time. Read it over a few times. Maybe, and as you do, imagine yourself engaging in that passage. Let's say you're reading some of the Gospels and you're reading the stories of Jesus interacting with people. Imagine what it might be like for yourself to be in that scene. You know, that be there listening with the others as Jesus tells that parable, or alongside of what would have been like to be the witness of that miracle that you just read about from Jesus, or what would have been like to have been the woman at the well. How would you have felt if you were in her shoes? Ask yourself, what do you see going on here? What do you smell? What do you taste? What do you touch? What would you hear if you were there with Jesus? Let yourself be drawn into the story to experience it as if it was firsthand for yourself. What are you noticing when you do that? What are you noticing about Jesus? What are you noticing about what Paul is saying to that church that you're reading, the book of Colossians or the Philippians, whatever that he's speaking to that church? What would have been like for you to have heard that as a member of that church? What is this passage telling you about God? What is this passage telling you about Jesus? About humanity, about yourself? You see what you're doing there? You're not just reading the passage to get through it, to get it over with. You're reading the passage to ruminate in it, to sit in, to abide in it, to stay in the place of your imagination. You might even begin to ask yourself, okay, what specifically is Jesus trying to tell me in this passage? What is it that God wants to teach me? And you might find as you read that passage that that there's a word or a phrase or a verse that keeps coming back to you. Why is that? What is it in your life that God is trying to speak to you about from that single verse or that single word? You might have a journal with you if you want to write some of these things down. As you respond to the passage, as it speaks to you, you might write some of those things down. Okay, God, I'm really feeling like you're maybe it's conviction that you're feeling, or maybe it's encouragement that you're feeling, or maybe it's an action, something to do as a result. So write those things down. Engage those things. Maybe you're listening to Jesus talking and you're realizing, you know what? This friend of mine keeps coming up. And this relationship that I have with this friend hasn't been going very well lately. And I really need to ask them to forgive me about something. And that's what God is trying to speak to you about through His Word, through that passage that day. And so your response to that would be then to go and to make sure you engage in that act of asking for forgiveness. Or it might be that as you're reading a passage and it's maybe about someone who's struggling and Jesus brings healing into their lives, and you think about somebody in your family who's going through a tough time, and that person's name just keeps coming, or their picture just keeps coming to your mind as you read that particular passage of Scripture. Maybe what God is telling you in that moment of meditation is that that person needs a word of encouragement from you. And so then you get to go and be an agent of God, an agent of God's encouragement. Be a Barnabas to that person and encourage them where they are. Do you see how this works? We're meditating we're not just gaining knowledge here. We're engaging God through the Scriptures. We're allowing God to speak to us through the Scriptures, and we're responding with action. Meditation is about actively engaging with Scripture that leads to action. This is a different way of engaging Scripture. This is a slower way of engaging Scripture. Now, I know that we have done Bible readings where we read through the Bible in a year, and you're doing 3 and 4 chapters a day, and that's great. I'm not knocking that in any way, shape, or form. But you need to understand this is different. This is crockpot reading as opposed to microwave reading, okay? In a crockpot, you want things to simmer, you know? You want those juices to kind of get together and make some really good flavor to that meat, you know? In a microwave, all you're doing is making a Hot Pocket, okay? This is not Hot Pocket stuff. This is a good, juicy roast. And you're going to savor the flavors. You're going to really get into that and meditate on God's Word. You know, I started doing this recently with the book of James. It's one of my favorite books in the New Testament, one of my favorite epistles, because James is hard-hitting, and he tells it like it is, and he's very, very, very practical. And when I began reading and meditating through the book of James, I got through the first verse, and that's where God said stop. And so I read through that first verse of James, which says this. Let me read it to you. It says, "This letter is from James, a slave of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. I am writing to the 12 tribes, Jewish believers, scattered abroad." Now, I was ready to go on, but for some reason, that word slave got stuck in my craw. And I began to think about that word, and I thought, you know what? That word doesn't have the same connotation for James as what we think about slavery today and in our history and unjust slavery and things like that. The kind of word there that he's using is more about someone who is willing to humble themselves and be a servant for God. In fact, if you look in other, I started looking it up in other passages, other translations, and that word there for slave is bondservant. That word there also means someone who's a willing participant and servitude. So James is basically saying there, in an amazing way, that I am saying out front, I'm introducing myself to you as someone who walks in service to God. I am a servant of God. I began thinking to myself, how do I introduce myself to people? You know, is the idea of being God's servant so much a part of my identity that I introduce myself to people as, hi, I'm David, I'm a servant of God? You know? But yet that's what James was doing. Servanthood, serving, submitting oneself, humbling oneself before God, in James's mind, was so central to his identity that it shaped even how he introduced himself. That really hit me. Just that one word stuck out to me. And I began to think to myself, do I see myself as a servant of God in that way, at that level? Do I humble myself that way, or is my ego too much in the way? You know, am I willing to submit myself to God to be his servant, even in situations or even with people that maybe I'm uncomfortable with, or maybe I don't want to? Or am I willing to be that kind of a person for God with every interaction that I come into? And then you know what popped into my mind next? The fact that there was a dish full of dirty dishes that my family needed for me to clean. In fact, it was my job to clean them, and I didn't do it. And so I got up after that 20 minutes of meditation, and for 5 minutes, I went and did all the dishes in the sink. It's not just reading the Word of God. It's not just meditating on the Word of God. It's allowing the Word of God to speak to you in such a way that it moves you into action. Okay? Now, that was just my experience. What's your experience going to be? Well, it depends on where you are. It depends on what God wants to say to you and what he's calling you to through his word. But it begins with fixing our thoughts. It begins with training our minds. It begins with sitting in that crock pot of God's word and soaking all that in. Meditation is the ability to hear God's voice. This is what Richard Foster says. And obey God's word. Now, you all may be saying to yourself, now wait a second, preacher, we were talking about winning the war in your mind, you know. Your last few weeks, you've been talking about all these different techniques and tactics about, you know, how to retrain your thought processes and using filters and using frames. What in the world does this meditation stuff have to do with winning the war in your mind? And I'm going to tell you this morning, it has everything to do with winning the war in your mind. And to do that, I'm going to tell you about a parable that Jesus talks about in Luke chapter 11. It's the parable of the empty house. And in that parable, someone is delivered of an unclean spirit that had been tormenting them. And the unclean spirit is sent out into the wilderness, out into the desert, away far from that person. And they are left with a clean house, is the way the parable talks about. But it's in essence, it's talking about the person's mind. Their mind had been tormented by this critical spirit, maybe a negative spirit of some sort, a harmful spirit. All it says is either an evil spirit, or other translations say unclean spirit. Whatever it is, it's gone. And their mind, or their house, at that point has been swept clean, Jesus says. Well, it's not long that unclean spirit wanders around in the wilderness and decides, you know what? I'm tired of the wilderness. I'm going to go back and see if that place is available again. And so instead of just coming by itself, Jesus says that the unclean spirit then goes, gets seven other unclean spirits, and when it gets back to the house, it finds that, yes, it is still swept clean, but it is also still left empty. And so sure enough, the seven spirits come in, and the person is tormented even more than they were before. Why? Because they left the house empty. At the very end of the parable, Jesus says this in verse 28. He says, but even more blessed are all who hear the word of God and put it into practice. What's the point Jesus is trying to make in this parable? I believe Jesus is trying to tell us that it's not enough just to empty our minds of critical spirits. It's not just enough to empty our minds of impure spirits. Or it's not just enough to empty our mind of critical, harsh thoughts. We've got to fill our mind with the good stuff. We've got to fill our mind with the things of God. We've got to fill our mind with the Word of God. We've got to fill our mind with that which is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable and excellent and praiseworthy. Otherwise, these old thoughts will come back. And what we want to see happen is when they do try to come back, that the mind, our house, is already filled up with all this other good stuff. It's filled up with the Word of God. It's filled up with passages that we've meditated on. It's filled up with passages that we've memorized. It's filled up with the Word of God so much so that there's no room for that junk anymore. And there's no room for that critical spirit anymore. And there's no room for that negative spirit anymore. Do you see what Jesus is saying here? We've got to be filled. And we can do that in a very powerful way by spending time, by fixing our thoughts, by meditating on God's Word. I love the way Apostle Paul says in Colossians chapter 3, verse 16, he says, "Let the Word of God dwell in you richly," or richly in you. That word dwell, that's where we get the word dwelling. That's where we get the word house. Let the Word of God take up residence in your heart. Let the Word of God take up residence in your mind. Let it fill you up so much that that is what you savor. And there's not room for all that other stuff. To fill our house and our minds with that which is good so that we will be filled with the Word of God, so that no negative thoughts will be able to squeeze in, and so that our strongest thoughts, remember the strongest thoughts always lead our lives, our strongest thoughts are always going to be God-honoring thoughts because we have become people of the Word who live in the Word, who meditate on the Word, who just savor the Word. And so this is my challenge to you. Find some sort of a pattern of meditation in your life. And it doesn't have to be long. It's just every day, just take 10 minutes, take 15 minutes, take 20 minutes. And if this is new for you, start with the gospel. And don't try to take five chapters. I'm not even talking to a full chapter. I'm talking maybe a passage, a paragraph, a verse. Or go and take your favorite epistle. Mine's James. Maybe yours is Philippians. Maybe yours is Ephesians. Whatever it may be, take that. And just section by section, allow God to speak to you every day as you sit down and read that passage and read through it again. That's my challenge to you. Let's be people of the Word, so much so that the Word flows through our lives. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we do want to be people of your Word because it is in your Word that we win the battle for our minds. Fill our minds, O Lord, with your good thoughts, with your good lessons, with your commandments, with your truth. Speak it so real and so clear and so true to us that our lives are transformed by being filled with your Word, so that the stuff of the devil can't even get in the door. This I pray in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And everybody said, amen. This time I invite you to stand as we sing our closing song this morning. If God is here moving in your heart and life to profess your faith in Jesus Christ or to become a member of Bullard Methodist Church, we invite you to come talk to Pastor Tammy or I. And we'd love to answer any questions you may have, pray with you, share with you a vision for a life of a Christian, but also a vision for the life of the church. Let's continue as we sing together. Peace. Is a promise God keeps. So I pray, send you with this blessing. May the peace of Christ fill your heart. May it fill and flood and overflow into your heart, mind, body, and soul. And may you go forth and share that peace of Christ with the world. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and everybody said together, amen. Go in peace.